They beat me up so bad that my face was all bruised up. Still today, I am under medical attention because I had a brain injury, brain damage or something. They left me in a pool of blood, no treatment, no care, no nothing. I was dizzy after that, I could not walk straight, still today. Then they put me in the back of the boat. They tore the flag, the US flag, in the back of the boat. That deeply offended me. You know, it's my flag, my pride, that's the way I operate the boat. It's a US territory. And I could not believe, still today I'm shocked to my guts that Indians would attack a boat, a private yacht in international waters. If they get away with it, what's next? So they are attacked. No warning, no call on radio, because sometimes, you know, the Coast Guard, they call you on radio. They suspect something, or if there's something not right, they call you on radio, or they might ask you to stop the boat, but there is a process. But here, they did not ask anything. No question, no call on the radio, just a plain, brutal military attack. And they threw away the flag, bothered them, obviously. And they did not ask me who I was or anything like that. Then the Indians left and the Emiratis took over the boat. From there, the boat took another direction. I don't want to say I went back to the UAE because we did not come from the UAE. So they took us to the UAE and for 3 days. After 3 days, they changed the boat. They wanted to go faster. So they towed the yacht and they put us on a UAE military vessel, a big one again. And the Indian Coast Guard, they accompanied us for at least halfway. So they were on either side of the boat, following us, escorting us. So I really had no hope of doing anything. I thought of jumping in the water, you know. I prepared myself with a survival kit, but I could not even do that. I had jumped in the water, they would have found me after 3 hours. The Indian people, that's what they do, that's their job, find people in the water. And then I would have made it worse for myself. More beating, more control. So I was distressed. I thought I was going to die. So that's why I was exploring the idea of jumping in the water, because it may sound like risky to jump in the water, but not to me, because I thought I was going to die anyway. So why not try jump in the water? But anyway, I did not do it because it would not have worked. And then they took us back to the UAE. I don't know where, because we were blindfolded and handcuffed. It looked like a secret prison with nobody inside. I could not hear anybody. I did not see anybody. 24 hours in the room, in the cell. Only out to be questioned and interrogated. During my interrogation, I think it's irrelevant, you know, the quality of the food. People ask me how was the food, how they treat me. I think it's irrelevant. It doesn't matter if the food is good or if they treat you well, because the food was good and they treated me pretty well. But when you think you're going to be executed, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if the food is good or not, because you think you're going to die. So they asked me the same question. They asked me to testify, I mean to make a controlled testimony. But you are forced to do it anyway. You have no choice. It's not like you have a lawyer next to you helping you out, or you have to say what they want you to say. And quickly, maybe after 2 days, I realized they had a big problem, huge problem. It's the media. Probably what saved our lives. The release of Latifa's video and the public release from Radar. They had a problem. They asked me to, if I could change my story, how can I change my story? That's what happened. And they wanted to get rid of us. I did not know that what said in the news, but they wanted to get rid of us. They had a problem with us being there. So after 10 days or something, 8 days, they literally threw me back on the boat. The boat was in a military base. And I checked the boat quickly. They asked me to check it quickly so I could leave as soon as possible. The boat was badly damaged. I don't understand why the Indian Coast Guard, for instance, why did they slash my life raft? I have two life rafts. You know, a life raft is a boat sinks, that's what's going to save you. They destroy them. Why? I had two jet skis, they did not touch the jet skis. So why did they slash my safety equipment? Why did they steal my safety equipment? When they raided the boat, they looted the boat. Anything that was valuable, they stole it. So I'm talking about personal things. You know, they stole my shoes. Why would they steal my shoes? But they stole the binoculars, the radios, the GPS, you know, things that you need on the boat. So when they threw me back on the boat, I had basically an impaired boat. I did not have all the equipment that I needed, but I did not think about that. I was seeing my freedom, and I would have gotten from there in a rubber boat if I had to. And then I had 13 days crossing, going to Sri Lanka. There's no way I would go to India. To me, India is became a no-no country, a corrupt country, a thugs country. So I decided to go to Sri Lanka, but it took 13 days. 13 days of fear in my guts, thinking that they would blow up the ship. Because, you know, when you cross the Indian Ocean, there's nobody there. And sometimes, for 3 days, you don't see anybody. No ship, no cargo, no nobody. There's no yacht, of course. Who would even think going on vacation there? It's a dangerous area. And so for 13 days, I thought they were going to blow up the ship, to eliminate evidence and kill all the witnesses. That was tough. Eventually I made it to Sri Lanka, and now I'm here to talk about it. I knew Latifa for 8 years ago. She first contacted me after she heard from friends that I had escaped from Dubai in 2008. So when she contacted me, she said, well, since you did it, maybe you can help me. And for months, months after months, for 8 years, this poor young woman begged for my help. She wanted to go out. She told me who she was, so of course, if her father is the ruler, I needed to double check, you know, what she said was true, and how her father would take it. And she said, like, in the last 3 years, they exchanged 10 words. So to me, he told me, you know, father doesn't care. He doesn't take care of his daughter. So, because when they interrogated me in the prison, I had the feeling that they took it personally, that it was a personal attack against Sheikh Mohammed because I took his daughter. But I did not take his daughter. That was her own choice, her own decision. And for 8 years, 8 years is a long time when someone tells you every week, every month, I want to leave, I want to go out, I want to enjoy freedom in America or in Europe, I want to be free. I learned something, she taught me something, that because, you know, she comes from a rich family, so somehow she has money, even if she cannot spend it the way we can, because she has a limited freedom, but she still has access to money. It doesn't matter how much money you have. When you want freedom, freedom is priceless. She told me once she would rather flip burgers in America than being rich in the UAE. So, you know, I was touched. I wanted to help. I wanted to help her. I also challenged her because I said, this is no joke. If you do that, you're going to change your life. You're going to change my life. You're going to change Tina's life. Because those are dramatic steps. But she was committed. And when, in summer 2017, she made the final decision. Also because she had lost hope to help her sister. She thought that, she was convinced that she would be able to help her sister from the outside, not from the inside. So that's when she decided to escape. So I was waiting in international waters. I did not break any law. I was always in international waters, and they came to the boat. I mean, not completely, because the weather was bad. I had to bring them up with I had to pick them up with the jet ski. But they came to the boat, and then we started the trip to India, where hopefully she would fly to America. And we were caught. We were attacked. I don't want to say we were arrested, because we were not. When you are arrested, when you do something illegal, you are busted, and the police, they catch you for something. But that's not the case. We were attacked and kidnapped. All of them. When they attacked the boat, Latifa just disappeared. They dragged her off the boat. Never heard from her ever since. And here we are.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that, Hervé. I'm going to hand over now to Rada Sterling. I'm going to hand over to David first. And it's important to note that David and Rada were the first point of contact with Latifa during her brave attempts to escape, and certainly my contact with this team. So, as I've said, David is also a victim of torture himself. So I'll hand over to David now so he can explain his involvement and what he's been doing.
Thank you, Toby. I wanted to sit here and explain to all of you how Rada and I got involved with what you heard about today and what you saw on the video, because I think that will help you see the magnitude of this international incident. I think it was about a couple of months ago, I talked to Rada on a daily basis. Rada sent me an email that had been forwarded to her, and it read, "My name is Sheikh Latifa, daughter of the ruler of Dubai, and to get a long story short, I'm in trouble, I'm being abused and tortured, and I need your help." I think the first message I sent back to Rada was, it's a scam, it can't be real, it must be someone having a joke. It sounded so dramatic and so shocking. And then shortly after that, Rada received messages on WhatsApp, calls through Facebook and messages. And then we started the process of looking to verify if Latifa was who she claimed she was. And it took us about a week, but we did that. And we did that through various different ways, because it was important for us before we got involved and before we spoke to the press about what was happening, that what from various different people that she was associated with when I was there. We then, Rod and I, the team at Detained in Dubai, started to put together a plan of how we could help them and how we could get the press interest, which is something that Latifa wanted because she felt it was the only thing that could protect her from her father and from what she knew was coming. So in the background, and we were busy trying to help them and busy trying to plan for asylum for Latifa. And throughout that process, Latifa sent us various documents, various messages, various voice messages, instructions, and things that she needed help with. Then on a few days before